Thank you for taking the time to view this session. Today we're going to be talking about some Outlook common client-side troubleshooting tools. During the course, we're going to discuss some different steps that you can take to help isolate and resolve problems with Outlook. Once the course is complete, you'll understand the Outlook profile architecture and be familiar with some of the built-in troubleshooting tools for Outlook. We'll specifically talk about profile architecture in depth. We'll talk about how to use profile testing to isolate issues, how to use the connection status dialog, and how to use the test email auto configuration utility. Let's get started by talking about profile architecture. The Outlook profile is stored in the registry and it contains pointers to various things, including other items that are stored within the file system and a configuration of accounts. The Outlook profile in Outlook 2010 and earlier is stored in the Windows Messaging Subsystem section of the registry. In Office 2013, the Outlook profile is stored in the Office Hive. We will take a look at where the profile is stored for Outlook 2010 when we get to the demo. Direct modification of the profile within the registry is not supported. We provide a mechanism to manage profiles using the mail applet within the Windows control panel, and we'll look at today how to use that to create and manage profiles. In addition to the profile itself, we use several storage mechanisms for different types of accounts. Exchange cached mode uses an OST that is stored within the user profile. Exchange Online mode does not have a local store. We'll talk about that a little bit more later. But anything that you're accessing in Exchange Online mode is a request to the Exchange server. IMAP accounts are stored in a PST up to Outlook 2010. In Outlook 2013, IMAP accounts are stored in an OST, similar to what you see with an Exchange cache mode account. POP accounts use a PST in all versions of Outlook. And Exchange ActiveSync accounts, which are specific to Outlook 2013, also use an OST. An example of an Exchange ActiveSync account would be an Internet Mail account, such as Hotmail. There are also local files within the Windows NT profile for address books. Those are represented in the case of Exchange using OAB files. So using profile testing can help you isolate several issues. We'll specifically talk to Exchange profiles during most of this section of the presentation and some of the differences between cached and online mode. Whenever you experience an issue in Outlook, it's always a good idea to test with a new profile first and foremost, but also to compare what happens with an Exchange cached mode profile versus what happens with an Exchange online mode profile. We'll talk about why that is in just a moment here, but it can help you learn a lot about the issue just by doing that. We also always want you to use new profiles to test. It's pretty easy to go in and convert an existing profile from cached or online, but we definitely want to try with a new profile. The reason for that is that converting a profile between cached and online mode can lead to some unexpected behavior, such as an online mode profile using an OAB or unexpected message submit behavior. So if you have an issue, really easy test, you know, regardless of what the issue is go into the mail applet within Control Panel and create a new profile. We'll take a look at how to do that in the demo. Specifically with Exchange profiles, there are several differences between Exchange and cached and online mode. I have a few listed here. And this is the reason that we want to contrast the behavior between those two types of profiles, because it can help you identify whether something is a client issue or whether it is a server issue. The first of those is with message submit. Messages that are sent with an Exchange cache mode profile are first submitted to the local cached outbox, which that outbox is not synchronized with the server. Once the message is placed in the local cache mode outbox, Outlook will then submit the message to transport, then sync that message to sent items, and the sent items are then synced up to Exchange. So in Exchange cache mode, when you send a message, the message does not enter the server outbox. Conversely, if you look at Exchange online mode profiles, when you send a message, you submit directly to the server outbox. The Exchange server is responsible for submitting that message to transport and creating the sent item. So if there's a breakdown in any of those processes, contrasting a cached versus online mode profile might help you identify where the difference is. A good example of that is with delayed delivery. So with delayed delivery, when you send the message is placed in the outbox until that delayed delivery time happens. In cached mode, the client is responsible for sending that message because it is sitting in the local cached mode outbox. In online mode, the server is responsible for sending that delivery message because that's where the message is sitting. The next item that I have included here is view render. When you're using a cached mode profile, views are rendered from the OST for the primary mailbox. That means that when you're switching between folders or views within a folder, they require a call to the local OST, but not to the server. View renders for any additional mailboxes that are not the primary mailbox are dependent on the setting for download shared folders. We'll take a quick look at that in the demo as well. In Exchange online mode, views are rendered by the server for the primary mailbox and additional mailboxes. So each time you're switching between a folder or a view within a folder, it requires a request and response from the server. Another distinction between the two types of profiles is search. In Exchange cached mode, if Windows Desktop Search is present on the machine, which is a downloadable component for Windows XP and an inbox feature for Vista, Windows 7, Windows 8, it is the local system is responsible for indexing your data files, whether it's an OST or a PST, and returning results for those files. Advanced Find, which is another feature within Outlook, still uses the Exchange server index, but your instant search that's present right in the main UI of Outlook is a local request. If we contrast that with online mode, search, even from that main search UI, is still using the Exchange server index since there's no data on the client index. As we talked about earlier, with an Exchange online mode profile, there's nothing on the client. It's all stored on the server. So each time you do a search in Exchange online mode, you are submitting a request to Exchange, and Exchange is returning the results. So testing those two profiles with search issues can help you isolate if there's potentially an issue with the index or if the issue is on the Exchange server. The last difference that I'm going to mention here is address book. This is by no means a conclusive list, but there are several differences we wanted to call out. In Exchange cached mode, Outlook is using the local offline address books files, or OAB, if they are present on the system. If you are using the Exchange online mode profile, Outlook is using the GAL, which is comprised of Active Directory data returned from the catalog server. With that, let's move on to a demo and let's take a look at how some of these things work. What we have here is a Outlook 2010 client running on top of Windows 7. I already have the registry editor open. And you can see that I have it expanded to HKEY Current User, Software, Microsoft, Windows NT, Current Version, Windows Messaging Subsystem. This is where the Outlook profile is stored. So if I drill one more level into this, and then into the Profiles section, you'll see the listing of all the profiles that are on the system. Now, in this case, I only have one profile added, and that profile is named Outlook. That's the default profile name, so you may see a similar configuration on many of your clients. If I expand that profile, within there I'll see a number of GUIDs. All of these GUIDs contain information about the accounts that are added to the profile, the data files, and so on. Again, we don't support modifying this section of the registry, and as you look through it, you can see that most of it is not human readable. Let's close out of there and let's go into Outlook. When I launch Outlook, you can quickly see that I am connected using a cached mode profile because it says connected to Microsoft Exchange at the status bar of Outlook. If you're using an online mode Exchange profile, you would see online with Microsoft Exchange here. Through Outlook, if I go to the File tab and then Account Settings, account settings, I can get to some data about the profile. I can see my Exchange account. I'll click Change here to view some of that information. This confirms which server I'm connected to and also which user account I'm using. I also see that I'm in cache mode, which confirms what shows in the status bar earlier. If I click on More Settings and then Advanced, we can see one of the settings that I referred to earlier in the presentation, which is Download Shared Folders. When you're using a cache mode profile, we cache your primary mailbox to the OST. If the Download Shared Folders checkbox is selected, we also cache any additional mailboxes that you have open or additional shared folders that you open, such as other people's calendars, resource room calendars. This checkbox is the default and it is our recommended setting. One side effect of it that you might notice is if you're caching very large additional mailboxes or very large additional folders, you might see the OST size grow as a result of this box being checked. Again, it is our default and recommended setting for Outlook 2010. So let's say that I have a problem with Outlook and I want to do some profile testing to help isolate whether that problem is specific to cached or online mode profiles. Let's walk through what that process looks like. So first I'm going to close out of Outlook and go into the control panel. I already have the control panel open here in small icons view. I'm going to go to the Mail 32-bit applet, which is a utility that I can use to manage the profiles that are added to this system. When I click on this, I get Mail Setup-Outlook. Now, in this case, Outlook is referring to the name of the profile, not specifically Outlook the application. From here, if I click on Email Accounts, I can get back to that same dialog that we had within the Outlook UI and do the same type of account management from here. So from email, I can manage email accounts, data files, if there are PSTs added, for example. I can also manage address books if I have address books or a number of other things that are listed here. But in this case, we're interested in creating a new profile, so we'll click on the Show Profiles dialog. And there's a few different options in here. Before we get to the actual creation of the new profile, I want to talk about the options that are at the bottom of the dialog. Whenever I'm doing profile testing with a machine, I always switch to Prompt for Profile. It makes it a little bit easier to switch between profiles as you do your testing. The other advantage that it has is it allows you to see if Outlook is closing properly. If you have this option selected and you are not prompted for a profile when Outlook starts, it's a good indication that Outlook did not close properly the last time that you launched it. Let's click Add here. The other thing that I like to do is give myself some cues as to what that profile is being used for. So I'm going to call this one Test Profile Online. Click OK. It's going to take me through the new account creation process. And I'm going to check the box in the bottom left corner to manually configure server settings. If I click Next here, I have the ability to clear the cached exchange mode checkbox, and now I will be creating an online mode profile. I'm doing profile troubleshooting. I usually like to create an online mode profile first. There's a couple of reasons for that. First, in this case, we have a cached mode profile as the default, so it will allow us to contrast that cached mode profile easily. The other is that with users that have large mailboxes, creating an online mode profile is much faster than creating a new cached mode profile. There's no need to download all of the mailbox to the OST. So I'll click OK on that. Launch Outlook. I'm now prompted for profile. I'm going to go to my online mode profile. And now I have an online mode profile as indicated by this message in the status bar, and I can test for my issue. If the issue does not follow to this new profile, I might want to test with another cached mode profile, and I could go back into the mail applet and run that test. We can take this a step further. If we know that there's a problem with both profiles on the system, we might want to do some additional isolation to see if it's a problem with the NT user account on this machine or if it's a problem with the user's mailbox on Exchange. There's a couple ways that we can do that. The first is to have another user log on to this machine and create a profile to this user's mailbox. If that works, then we know that there's some kind of problem with the NT user account on the machine. If the problem follows to that account, we may have a machine profile or may have a machine issue, or we might have an issue with the user's mailbox. To further isolate it, we can have this user move to a different machine and log on there. If the problem follows them to that machine, there could be a problem with their Exchange mailbox or something stored on that mailbox. If I isolate that the problem is specific to cached mode, might want to start taking a look at things that are specific to the client, specifically some of those things that we called out earlier in the presentation. For example, if we have a search issue that is specific to a cached mode profile, we might want to start taking a look at the indexing on the system and make sure that indexing is completing successfully. If we have a problem with submit and we are using a cached mode profile, I want to take a look at machine-specific items such as add-ins that are running with Outlook. Let's move on to the next section. Next, I want to talk about the connection status dialog. The connection status dialog displays the list of connections that Outlook currently has open to various different servers. For Exchange, that will include your Exchange mailbox connection, your directory connection, and your public folders connection. If you are using other types of mail accounts, such as Hotmail or an Internet Mail account with Outlook 2013, you might see Exchange ActiveSync connections in there or IMAP connections. If you have connections to an LDAP address book, you'll see that LDAP connection listed as well. In addition to the listing of the different connections that are open, you'll also see metrics about those connections. The last thing that the connection status dialog provides is a mechanism to manually reconnect. Let's switch over and take a look at the connection status dialog and the functionality that's available. All right, we're back on our Windows 7 Outlook 2010 client to take a look at the connection status dialog. So I have my cached mode Exchange profile open. And to bring up the connection status dialog, I need to right-click on the system tray icon for Outlook while holding the control key on the keyboard. So if I right-click on that, you'll see that the connection status option is available. If I'm not holding the control key down, that connection status or the test email auto configuration for that matter will not display. So let's bring up the dialog. You can see that I have a summary of the connections that I currently have open to my Exchange server. I have two mail connections open, and at this time I don't have any directory or public folders connections open. Now in this specific lab, I do not have a public folders server, so I'm not going to see a connection to public folders. If you don't see one in your environment, that could mean something similar. It could mean that you do not have a public folders server. It could also mean that you haven't created a connection to that server yet. I would caution you that because the public folders server connection is not present, does not mean that we're not using public folders. If your public folders are hosted on the server that you have a mailbox connection to, you might not see an extra public folders connection. So for each of my mail servers, I see the server I'm connected to. In this case, it's the CAS, since this is Exchange 2010. I can see some metrics about that connection that I'm using TCP IP. This is not Outlook Anywhere. If it was Outlook Anywhere, I would see HTTPS listed here. Sometimes it's useful to test if there are differences between issues in Outlook Anywhere or connected over TCP. I can see some response times and how we're connected to that server. The last thing that I see is the version. The version is a great way to quickly get the Exchange version that you're connected to if you don't have access to the server. In this case, I see that my Exchange version is 14.3. That tells me that I am connected to an Exchange 2010 server that is at Service Pack 3. With Exchange 2007 and 2010, the second octet in the version is the Service Pack level. With Exchange 2007, you'll see 8.1 or 8.2 or 8.3, the 8 dot indicating it's Exchange 2007 and the second octet indicating that you are the service pack level of that Exchange 2007 server. We have the ability to restore connectivity by clicking this reconnect button. If we do that, it will disconnect all current connections and attempt to reconnect. When I click the button, that happened very fast. I'm in a lab where everything is on the same VLAN. So very, very quick here, probably not as quick in practice, but will allow you to initiate a manual reconnect. With that, let's move on to the next section. The last utility that I want to talk about today is the test email auto-configuration utility. Test email auto-configuration will give you a look into the auto-discover information that's being returned by the Exchange server. Exchange provides user-specific information during the auto-discover process that is essential to several different features within Outlook. One of the pieces of information that is returned is connection information. This includes how to connect to Exchange via TCP or HTTPS, otherwise known as Outlook Anywhere. We have information such as the server name and the authentication type that should be used, among other pieces of information. Another feature that's dependent on AutoDiscover is the offline address book. The OAB URL is returned through AutoDiscover, and if it is not correctly returned, Outlook will not be able to download the OAB for use in cache mode clients. Another feature that is reliant on AutoDiscover working correctly is the availability service. The availability service is used when users use the scheduling tab on meeting requests to see if other users are available at that time. Without working AutoDiscover, this feature will not work. The out-of-office assistant uses a similar mechanism as the availability service. In order for users to successfully set their out-of-office reply, you need to have working AutoDiscover information. The last item that we have listed here, which is by no means a comprehensive list, is auto-mapping. Auto-mapping is a feature that automatically adds accounts that users have full mailbox access to in Outlook without them having to manually add those accounts. One example of this is archived mailboxes with Exchange 2010 and above. Without working AutoDiscover, an archived mailbox will not be able to be successfully added within Outlook. Let's flip over to a demo and take a look at AutoDiscover and the test email auto-configuration utility. As you can see, we're back on our demo client that we've been using throughout the presentation. I'm going to bring up the test email auto-configuration utility in a similar way that I brought up the connection status dialog. I'll bring up the Outlook system tray icon, hold down Control on my keyboard, and right-click, and here I have test email auto-configuration. Since we're testing AutoDiscover, we always want to clear this use guest smart and secure guest smart authentication. We only want to test AutoDiscover. The user that I'm logged in with is populated as email address. You do have the ability to change this if you need to get AutoDiscover information for a different user. I'm going to go ahead and click test, and we'll see some results. Enter AutoDiscover completes. So there's three tabs here. Each one of them has some different information on it. We'll start with the results tab. This gives us a summary of what happened. We have the URL that we use to auto-discover, so I auto-discovered against my Exchange 2013 server in this environment. I can see the availability service URL is being returned correctly, so I should be able to use availability within Outlook. I can also see the out-of-office URL and several other pieces of information here. If I go over to the log package, or the log tab, it will tell me the process that the client went through to perform AutoDiscover. So we were referred to my Exchange 2007 server through SCP, started. We got a 302 and were referred to a different server, which is the my Exchange 2013 server, where we were able to successfully perform AutoDiscover. The last tab is the XML tab, and this is the raw data that's returned by AutoDiscover. It's a little bit difficult to read in this window. Usually I like to pull it out into a notepad file, so let's do that. This makes the data a little bit easier to review. So we can see the raw XML that was returned. We can see a lot of that same data that we saw on the results tab. I can see the server that I need to connect to, the DN for that server, the mailbox DN that I'm connecting to. Here I have my availability service URL, which is actually a piece of EWS functionality. EWS is returned separately. If I had Outlook Anywhere configured, I would see some additional information for that. And if I had additional mailboxes that were being auto-mapped, I would see a section called Alternative Mailbox. If any of these pieces are missing from your AutoDiscover and you're having problems related to those items, such as accessing the availability service or accessing your directory server, you might want to take a look at your AutoDiscover setup on the Exchange server to make sure that everything is working correctly. One other thing that I want to mention before we close that we didn't specifically discuss on the slides is how to access the command line switches for Outlook 2010. Let's bring up our main Outlook 2010 window, and I'm just going to click on the Help button in the top right corner, And in the help, I'll type in command line switches. My first result is going to be command line switches for Outlook 2010. The same content is available if you search for it out on the web. But if we scroll through this list, this article down towards the bottom, you'll see a listing of the different switches that are available for Outlook 2010. As you use some of the strategies we talked about to isolate issues, some of these switches might be useful in taking that a step further to resolve the issue. The switches are slightly different across versions, so if you're using any of these switches, I would encourage you to search for the specific version that is in use on the client you're troubleshooting. Thanks for taking the time to view this session. I hope that you've learned some valuable troubleshooting skills for Outlook, learned a little bit about profile architecture and some of the built-in utilities that will help make troubleshooting within Outlook a little bit easier.